Hello guys, welcome to another session of RBI 24/7. My name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this new session. So guys, I hope all of you are doing great, and if you are preparing for competitive exams, then this session can be beneficial for you, right? So let's not waste any time and move straight away to our questions. But before doing that, I would like to do the customary thing. I would like to ask you to subscribe to our channel. So if this is the first video of our channel that you are watching, then do not forget to hit this subscribe button, and you can also press this bell icon which is flashing here on the screen if you want to get notified whenever a new video comes. Apart from that, you can also join our Telegram group for all the queries and all the doubts, and we'll try to solve them as soon as possible. So guys, are you ready for question number one? This is your question number one. I hope the screen is perfectly visible. This question says, which of the following buyers are the strategic buyers? So basically, there are certain buyers given to you. There are certain transactions which are given to you, and you have to tell that which of these buyers are strategic buyers and which of the following are financial buyers. Basically, here we are going to discuss the distinction between two type of buyers, strategic and the financial ones. So here you have to tell which ones are the strategic buyers, right? So moving ahead to the solution for this question, and the correct option for this question is option B. Option B means, just a second, option B means 1, 3 and 4. That means 1 is a strategic buyer, 3 is a strategic buyer, and 4 is a strategic buyer. I hope the screen is perfectly clear to you. Just a second. Okay. Now discussing about the features of both the type of buyers. Here you can see. See, you can figure out from their names only, strategic and financial. Strategic comes from the word strategy. Basically, कोई strategy बनाना, कोई जंग जीतने के लिए, if you want to win a war or if you have to achieve a particular goal, then you make a strategy. For example, if your exams are approaching, तो आप भी plan करते हो कि कौन सा subject कितना पढ़ना है, कौन सा subject आपकी strength है, कौन सा weakness है, and you make a strategy कि मुझे इतना इतना दिन इस subject को देना है. Similar goes for the companies. Companies, they have to achieve certain goals, and they have short-term goals and long-term goals. So if they want to achieve their goals, they also make some strategy, they also do some planning that we have to do this, we have to do that. So if one company is buying another company with the reason to fulfill their long-term goals, and it comes under the plan or the strategy that they have made, then they will be known as a strategic buyer. Whereas, if they want to make money, if they are only looking for the money and they are not concerned with the nature of the company, and what they want to do is just buy the company and sell it off in a few years just to make some profit, then it's a financial buyer. Guys, here you can see the difference between both. Strategic buyers focus heavily on synergies and integration capabilities. That means, एक जो स्ट्रेटेजिक बायर होगा वो ये देखेगा कि क्या मैं इस दूसरी कंपनी जिसको बाय कर रहा हूँ, क्या मैं इस कंपनी के साथ काम कर पाऊंगा, और वुड दिस न्यू कंपनी दैट आई एम बाइंग, वुड इट बी एबल टू फॉलो माय गोल्स, और वुड इट बी एबल टू अलाइन इट्स गोल विद माय गोल्स, राइट? सो दैट्स अ स्ट्रेटेजिक बायर. वेयर एज फाइनेंशियल बायर्स, दे लुक फॉर कैश जनरेटिंग केपेबिलिटी एंड द कैपेसिटी फॉर अर्निंग्स एंड ग्रोथ. Here you can see the correct answer was B, 1, 3 and 4. So here you can see Medanta Hospitals. Medanta बहुत बड़ा नाम है hospitals में and health sectors field में. They buying a company called Practo to extend its doctor's guidance to provide medical consultancy to patients. See, here they are not looking for any financial goal. यहाँ पे उनका purpose क्या है कि हमारे जो doctors का reach है, we should extend it and we should extend the consultancy services of our doctors to a large number of people using some technology which Practo uses. So here they are trying to align the products and services of Practo with Medanta. ऐसा नहीं है कि वो Practo को कुछ साल में बेच देंगे. They are trying to align both the goals. Right? Moving ahead to the next point, strategic buyers plan to keep newly purchased business indefinitely. They don't plan to sell the business, but they want to keep it and they want to work with the particular company. Basically, ये जो बायर है ये क्या चाहता है कि मैं जो नई कंपनी खरीद रहा हूँ उसकी स्ट्रेंथ्स और मेरी स्ट्रेंथ्स आपस में कंबाइन हो जाए एंड वी शुड बी एबल टू प्रोवाइड अ बेटर प्रोडक्ट और अ बेटर सर्विस टू आर कस्टमर्स फुल्ली इंटीग्रेटिंग द कंपनी इनटू देयर एग्जिस्टिंग बिजनेस वेयर एज फाइनेंशियल बायर्स दे हैव अ लिमिटेड टाइम दे प्लान ऑन सेलिंग द कंपनी इन सम 5 to 7 ईयर्स कमिंग बैक टू द स्ट्रेटेजिक बायर्स Acquirers are usually wedded to a general industry. Basically, यहाँ पे जो buyer होगा, एक strategic buyer अपने most of the time they try to buy within the range that they are having within the industry they are working. For example, अभी हमने Medanta और Practo का example देखा. Medanta is a group of hospitals. अगर Medanta कोई Ola जैसी company खरीद ले, which is into logistics, that would be quite strange. Or let's say Medanta buys स्विगी और जोमैटो देन इट्स गोइंग टू बी क्वाइट स्ट्रेंज क्योंकि एक जगह लोगों को जंक फूड खिला रहे हैं और दूसरी जगह उनका इलाज कर रहे हैं राइट सो द स्ट्रैटेजी ऑब्वियसली के नॉट बी मेकिंग पीपल इल सो दैट दे कैन ट्रीट देम बैक सो दिस इज गोइंग टू बी रियली बिजार बट येस इफ इट बायज अ कंपनी लाइक प्रैक्टो वेयर दे वॉन्ट टू अलाइन द मेडिकल सर्विसेज प्रोवाइडेड बाय बोथ ऑफ द प्लेटफॉर्म्स देन इट मेक्स सेंस राइट So strategic buyers, they are usually wedded to a general industry by nature of their core products and services, right? Coming to financial buyers, not wedded to a single industry because financial buyers ko kya hai? Unko to paise se matlab hai. That is why they don't care about the industry. Jahan paisa milega, jo badhiya company lagegi, wahi invest karenge. So probably there can be a venture capitalist firm or there can be a private equity firm which can buy a company like Ola which is into commutation or a company like Zomato which is providing food or let's say it can invest into Practo or it can invest into a range of services, right? So they are not wedded to a general industry but they decide both. They decide on both. They take both parameters into the consideration, business and attractiveness of the broader industry. जिस इंडस्ट्री में वो इन्वेस्ट करने जा रहे हैं उसकी क्या अट्रैक्टिवनेस है दे माइट इन्वेस्ट इनटू सम फाइनेंस फिनटेक कंपनी विच इज प्लेइंग विद क्रिप्टो करेंसी सो दे डू नॉट हैव अ जनरल फील्ड बट दे माइट लुक दैट ओके दिस फिनटेक फील्ड इज ग्रोइंग लेट अस इन्वेस्ट इनटू सम कंपनी वर्किंग हियर या फिर हेल्थ टेक इज ग्रोइंग लेट अस इन्वेस्ट इनटू सम कंपनी विच इज वर्किंग इन दिस फील्ड राइट सो नॉट वेडेड टू अ पर्टिकुलर इंडस्ट्री स्ट्रैटेजिक बायर going to focus less on the strength of the target companies existing back office and infrastructure so they don't look much for the infrastructure ki jis company ko hum khareed rahe hain uska infrastructure kaisa hai ya fir is it efficient or not because they know that ultimately this might be possible that there will be no existence of the other company and that company will be totally submerged into this strategic buyer For example, coming back to the example of Medanta and Practo, if Medanta group of hospitals buy Practo, then it might be possible that Medanta may be HR hoga, Practo may be HR hoga, yahan pe bhi finance department hoga, yahan par bhi finance department hoga. So there is redundancy. So this buyer might get rid of some of the departments of the bought company in order to reduce the redundancy, right? Whereas financial buyers, they are not concerned with the management. They are not. They don't have to align that particular company with their own goals. ये अपना अलग काम करते हैं और जिस कंपनी को ये खरीद रहे हैं वो अलग काम कर रही हैं. So that is why they need कि जिस कंपनी को खरीद रहे हैं उसका इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर अच्छा हो, उसका HR सिस्टम अच्छा हो, उसकी अकाउंटिंग मार्केटिंग सिस्टम अच्छा हो, right? Whereas they know that we might reduce some of the departments. That is why what they are concerned. What they are concerned with is that how the company would align with their own goals. So that is the difference between strategic and financial buyers. Coming back to the topic, coming back to the statements, here you can see Medanta, I told you how it was correct. Okay, 1, 3, and 4 were correct and second was incorrect. Why second is incorrect? Because private equity firm is looking to buy Dunzo and it plans to sell it in coming 5 years and then obviously they are looking for some financial gains Byju's acquisition of Akash so that they can broaden their reach into NEET examinations. Obviously, they are trying to align Akash with their own services. Cosmetics company using recently derived funding to buy all of its major competitors. See, now in this example, they are trying to buy all of their competitors. Why is this so? ऐसा हो सकता है कि वो competitors को अपने साथ align कर ले. Secondly, it might be possible that they wanted to destroy competition out of the market. That is why they bought all the competitor firms, and now they are thinking to destroy all the firms, or they are thinking that let those firms not run efficiently so that they can die, they can move out of the market so that we can be the major leader. See, but there is also some strategy. If you buy your competitor, then also there is a strategy. You are looking to get rid of the competition. So that was about strategic and financial buyers. Okay, moving to the second question, which says, which of the following statements is correct about the Triffin paradox? Three statements given to you. You have to tell that which one is correct about the Triffin paradox. Guys, you can pause the video here and give a thorough look, give a thorough read to these statements, and then decide with your answer. So moving ahead to the correct statement, and the correct option for this question is option E. Option E means only third is the statement which is correct in respect to Triffin paradox. Now let us first try to understand the meaning of this word, which says Triffin paradox. I hope the screen is visible. Yes. So Triffin paradox. See, Triffin paradox comes from the name of a person jiski surname thi Triffin. Now this Triffin person, he was an economist, and what did he say? Triffin said that if there is a country and wo country chahti hai ki uski currency world ki reserve currency ban jaye. What is meant by the reserve currency? Reserve currency means that this particular currency is going to be used all over the world as an asset or as a safekeeping purpose, for the safekeeping purposes. For example, aaj agar hum US dollars ki baat kare, to most of the international contracts, they are denominated in USD. So they are denominated in US dollars. So US dollars have become a reserve currency. Dollars have become the reserve currency of the world, because everyone thinks that dollar is the safest currency and it is going to go nowhere. That is why let me buy some assets in dollar, or let me keep some stock of dollars so that I can have some safe asset in times of need. So now Triffin said that if there is any country which wants its currency to become the reserve currency of the world, then it would have to become ready for ever growing deficits. See, यहाँ पे जो correct answer है वो है deficits. Let us first discuss it first, then we can go back to these statements. Okay, so Triffin used to say that अगर एक currency है और वो चाहता है कि उसकी अगर एक country है और उसकी करेंसी जो है वो वर्ल्ड में काफ़ी पॉपुलर है, ऑल दी अदर कंट्रीज आर बाइंग इट, ऑल दी अदर कंट्रीज सेंट्रल बैंक्स आर बाइंग इट एंड सेफ कीपिंग इट, देन ऑब्वियसली इट वुड हैव टू इंक्रीज द सप्लाई ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर करेंसी. सो अगर US डॉलर्स को हम सेफेस्ट करेंसी मानते हैं, देन द फेडरल रिजर्व इट वुड हैव टू इंश्योर अ गुड सप्लाई ऑफ डॉलर्स all over the world, and us supply ki wajah se they are going to have certain deficits, for that they should be ready, because now this currency has increased so much, this currency has so much of money supply that the country is going to face deficits. And how is it so? We are going to learn about it. Okay, here you can see, by agreeing to have its currency used as a reserve currency, a country pins its hands behind its back because it cannot use its currency particularly. And basically, if there is one country jiski currency bahut zyada popular hai, then it loses some of the power to make changes with the money supply. Because see, if there is a lot of inflation in the country and they think ki we should reduce the money supply in the market, then other people, other countries of the world, they are not going to be so happy because they want that particular safe currency, especially in times of certain crisis. So this country would have to be ready to make its currency really liquid, right? To keep the global economy chugging along, may have to inject large amounts of currency into circulation, driving up the inflation at home. ऑब्वियसली बात है, अगर एक कंट्री है वहाँ पे बहुत ज़्यादा मनी सप्लाई हो रहा है, बेसिकली देयर सेंट्रल बैंक इज प्रिंटिंग टू मच मनी, देन इट माइट लीड टू इन्फ्लेशन बिकॉज द मनी सप्लाई ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर करेंसी इज रियली हाई. दिस हैपेंड इन इंडिया ऑल्सो लास्ट ईयर 2020 में. टू सपोर्ट द इकोनॉमी और टू किक स्टार्ट द कोविड रिडन इकोनॉमी, RBI infused liquidity into the market. They gave loans to banks and asked banks to lend further so that there is a lot of money in the market and the economy is kick-started. But when the central bank, it pushes too much money into the market, then ultimately there is more money in the market, and that more money, by using that more money, it can lead to inflation because there is going to be a higher demand for goods and services. Or that money, it can lead to it can result into stock markets, which can be dangerous for the country. So the point is that फेडरल रिजर्व को डॉलर्स की सप्लाई बनाकर रखनी होगी, बट इस सप्लाई की वजह से उनकी अपनी कंट्री में प्रॉब्लम्स हो सकते हैं, सच एज हाई इन्फ्लेशन, राइट? एंड इफ दे वॉन्ट टू कंट्रोल दिस इन्फ्लेशन, फिर उनको क्या करना होगा, अपने इंटरेस्ट रेट्स को इंक्रीज करना होगा इफ दे वॉन्ट टू कंट्रोल द इन्फ्लेशन एट होम. बट दैट माइट नॉट बी a very successful idea when your currency is going to be the reserve currency of the world. Here you can see, just a second. Okay. See, the more popular the reserve currency is relative to other currency, the higher its exchange rate and less competitive domestic exports industries become, right? So, जितनी ज़्यादा एक currency popular होती है, उससे क्या होता है, उसका exchange rate उतना ज़्यादा बढ़ जाता है. Because see, every country in the world is going to demand dollars when they know dollar is the safest currency. And if they are going to demand dollar, then what is going to happen? Dollar is going to appreciate in relation to the rest of the countries of the world. When a currency appreciates, then obviously their goods, that country's goods, they become expensive for the customers who are in abroad, and that leads to fall in their exports. So this is one problem, right? So the point is that this reserve currency, this is going to be an appreciated currency which might have some bad impact on the exports, right? And the country might not like it, but they have to keep the money going on, they have to keep the supply ample, they have to make their currency liquid so that it can be transferred to the other countries of the world, even if they want to reduce the supply to control the situation at home. Here you can see, this causes trade deficit for the country, currency issuing country, but makes the world happy. Reserve currency country decides to focus on domestic monetary policy. By not issuing more currency, then the world becomes unhappy. So, अगर ये अपनी supply को control करने की कोशिश करते हैं, आज अगर US हमें मना कर दे, तो हम तो किसी को dollars नहीं देते, then obviously the entire world is going to be unhappy. So that is why US has to keep the supply of dollars going on, and that supply can make US goods really expensive for rest of the countries. And agar inke goods expensive ho jayenge, then their exports are going to fall, which is not very good for the country in the longer run. Same goes here. If this increased money supply of dollars into market, they can lead to inflation. They can lead to inflation in US. And now, if they increase the interest rates to control this inflation, then their domestic manufacturers are going to suffer because the cost of manufacturing is going to go high, right? So this is the problems, these are the problems related to your currency becoming reserve currency of the world. First of all, not able to control inflation at home. Secondly, not able to increase your exports because your currency becomes really expensive for the world, right? So that is why Triffin said, if you want to make your currency reserve currency, then be ready for trade deficits because your currency is going to be appreciated. Okay, now going back to the statements, here you can see Triffin paradox says that dollar could not survive as the world reserve currency without requiring United States to run ever growing deficits. Agar deficits honge to hi US world ki reserve currency ban payega. Agar aap surplus chahte ho to then you cannot make your currency the reserve currency of the world. Popular reserve currency lifts its exchange rate, which hurts the currency issuing countries' exports. Is appreciation ki wajah se, lifting up of exchange rate ki wajah se, US ke exports are going to be impacted. This statement is obviously correct. It says, country that issues a reserve currency must balance its interest with the responsibility to make monetary decisions that benefit other countries also. So they cannot make decisions on their own. Basically, they need to look for others' needs also. See, this country having reserve currency has ultimately become a parent to other countries of the world. And when you are a parent, you have to think of your children before your own objectives, or before your own benefits, you have to look for the benefit of your kids. Same thing, US, before thinking about its own economy, they have to think about the impact that their currency changes, their money supply changes might have on other countries of the world, which are looking forward to buying dollars, right? So this is known as Triffin paradox. Moving ahead to the next question. The next question says, the telecom sector of an economy is dominated by three telecom companies. Unofficially, these three firms have colluded with each other to fix prices as they don't want to get involved in any price wars. Which out of the following options can pose as a threat to this cooperation of these telecom companies, right? Correct option for this question is option A, that is prisoner's dilemma. Prisoner's dilemma. See, this prisoner's dilemma, this is a concept which is very popular in general sense. For example, we have to understand it by taking an example. Let's say there are two friends, Henry and Dave. Ya fir agar hume Indian names lene hai, then we can take obviously Ram and Shyam. Although they don't look like thieves, but let's assume Ram and Shyam, they are two friends who are thieves, right? Now, both of these friends, Ram and Shyam, they are caught by the police and police are investigating them separately. Dono ko alag alag kamre mein band kar diya, dono choro ko. And police is saying, ab dono se pooch rahi hai ke batao, chori kisne ki. Now, they know if they turn on their friend, then they are going to get some reduce, then they are going to get free and they are going to get free and दूसरे वाले को सारी सजा हो जाएगी. So अगर राम बोल दे कि चोरी शाम ने की, तो obviously बात है राम को छोड़ देंगे because राम will become a witness और शाम को सजा हो जाएगी. And अगर शाम सेम चीज कर दे, शाम बोल दे कि राम ने चोरी की, then उसको राम को सजा हो जाएगी and शाम will be going free. But see, the problem here is both are in confusion कि क्या करें, या दोस्त को बचा लूं, या तो दोस्ती बचा लूं या खुद को बचा लूं. So they are in some sort of confusion, they are in a dilemma. Now what happens is, अगर दोनों में से कोई भी जुबान नहीं खोलता, दोनों में से कोई भी नहीं बताता, if no one of them tells that who is the actual thief, then none of them are going to, then they both are going to get some very small punishment, not a large punishment. So they are going to get a very small punishment, they can get off with a very small punishment. But the point is, see, the incentive is more. Ram इररिस्पेक्टिव ऑफ, राम को यही लगेगा अपने दिमाग में कि श्याम मुझ पे चीट करेगा, उससे पहले मैं बता देता हूँ पुलिस को कि चोरी श्याम ने की, सो दैट आई कैन गो फ्री। सो दोनों क्या करते हैं, राम श्याम का नाम ले लेता है और श्याम राम का नाम ले लेता है। बट इन दिस सिचुएशन द एंटिटी हु विंस इज पुलिस, बिकॉज अब पुलिस के पास दोनों के अगेंस्ट विटनेस है। सो इफ राम टर्न्स ऑन श्याम एंड श्याम टर्न्स ऑन राम, देन पुलिस हैव विटनेस फॉर बोथ ऑफ देम। दैट इज वाई पुलिस कैन गिव पनिशमेंट, दे कैन पीनलाइज बोथ ऑफ देम, राइट। The point here is, if they would have cooperated with each other, if both of them had stayed silent, ये सोच के कि अगर हम दोनों ही चुप रहेंगे, if both of us stay silent, then we are going to get a meager punishment, we are going to get a really small punishment. But see, the personal incentives, the selfishness in them, it made them turn on their friend, and now both of them are serving higher punishment, both of them are serving serious punishments. Rather, they would have stayed quiet, they would not have turned on each other, then they both could have got a very small punishment and it would have been easier for both of them. So the point that I want to make here is that the individualism or the selfishness, individualism ko hum bahut simple tarike se keh sakte hain ki mera interest pehle aata hai mere dost se, aur I am more important, what I want, my benefits are more important than my neighbor or my friend, right? So this sense of individualism makes people do certain things which are harmful at a bigger level, harmful at a macro level, right? For example, we throw garbage on roads, right? But the point is, we do not think that if we are polluting the environment, if we are throwing garbage on the road, then it is harmful for all of us at a macro level. Same goes for Ram and Shyam. If they would have stayed quiet, they would have got a small punishment. But now both of them are serving higher punishments or a serious punishments. So that is the point. If we think of others, if we think of a collective benefit rather than an individual benefit, then society can be better and profits can be more. We are not talking about society in general. This concept can be applied to economics also. And how can it be applied to economics? For example, we talk about oligopoly. Guys, we have discussed monopoly in one of our previous videos. What is monopoly? When there is only one seller in the market and no other seller. Oligopoly, when there are certain sellers in the market, two or three sellers in the market, basically more than two. So there are certain number of sellers in the market who dominate the market and they do not allow any other seller to sell their product, and they have unofficially colluded with each other. They have unofficially decided among themselves that we are going to collude, we are going to set prices because we do not want any sort of price war. That is why we are going to cooperate with each other so that there is no competition and benefit is there for every firm, right? But the point is, these firms, let's say if there are three firms, अगर हम टेलीकॉम सेक्टर की बात करें, we talk about this question, you can say that it is dominated by three telecom companies, right? Here you can see dominated by three telecom companies. So यहाँ पे तीन telecom companies हैं, T1, let's call them T1, T2 and T3, right? But the point is, if they have unofficially decided to collude with each other, then this cannot go for long because one of them is going to increase the price anyhow because of prisoner's dilemma, because they are going to think about their own benefit rather than the benefit of all of them. Although their benefit is harmful to the society, but this system, this collusion cannot carry out for long because one of them is going to defect, one of them is going to cheat the others by raising the prices. By moving the prices in any direction without consulting with each other. And if one of them, let's say T2, T1 reduces the price of its product, then obviously all the customers will rush towards T1, leaving T2 and T3, right? So basically, what prisoner's dilemma say is that individualism makes companies takes decision which can harm them in long run, Rather, if they would have cooperated with each other, they all would have stayed at benefit. Because if T1 reduces the price and tries to steal all the customers, then T2 and T3 are not going to stay behind. They are also going to reduce the price, and ultimately there is going to be a price war. Prices are going to be low, which means low profits for everyone. So this one company, and who was selfish, reduced the profits for everyone. Right, so I hope you are clear with this concept of prisoner's dilemma. So that is why prisoner's dilemma is a threat to such situation, because one of them is going to cheat the others and reduce the profits for everyone. Moving ahead, here you can see some more details about this. Paradox in decision analysis, in which two individuals acting in their self-own interest do not produce the optimal outcome. So, इसका नुकसान क्या होता है कि society में या economy में optimal outcome produce नहीं हो पाता, because they are looking for their own interest rather than thinking that let's cooperate and let's increase the profits for everyone. Parties choose to protect themselves at the expense of the other participant. Both participants find themselves in a worse state. So, नुकसान यहाँ पे दोनों को होगा, एक की individualism से भी. So, अगर आप collective benefit के बारे में सोचो, then obviously everyone can benefit. So, both of them are in a worse state as compared to initial situation, and rather if they would have cooperated with each other in decision making process, they would be in a better position. Over time, people have worked out variety of solutions to prisoner's dilemma in order to overcome individual incentives in favor of common good, right? So, although there can be some solutions to it, but this prisoner's dilemma exists as a problem in economics or in various, it can be applied in various fields, right? So, if we talk about it here, obviously this is in the benefit of consumers, but isse companies ka to sabka nuksan ho gaya, right? It is beneficial for consumers because ultimately they are going to get low prices, but companies, basically the member or the participants who were there, they are facing a loss. Moving ahead, okay, so this is the fourth question. It says, what does it refer to here? Two statements given to you, you have to identify what is the meaning of it here. So, correct option for this question is the direct participation program. Direct participation program. Guys, this is a very simple term. It's like a partnership where many people, they pool their resources, or combine their resources so that all of them can earn money out of a business venture. As you can see here, pooled entity offers investor access to a business venture's cash flow and tax benefits, right? But it is not a company, or it is not traded on stock exchanges. So it puts money into real estate or energy related ventures over an extended time frame. Basically, ye log kya karte hain? They look for certain investors who qualify certain parameters. So they will say that your income should be at least this much, or you should be investing at least this much of money, then only you can be a part of this DPP, right? Then you can become the investors. Aur isme do type ke investors hote hain, jinko hum partners bhi bolte hain, the general partners and the limited partners. So the limited partners, they contribute money, whereas the general partners, what they do is they manage. So limited partners, they bring money, whereas general partners, they manage. Limited partners cannot say anything to general partners regarding management because it is their job. Although if they think general partners are not doing something which is in interest of all the investors, then they can sue them, or then they can change the general partners, right? So basically, limited partners, they bring the money, they are getting the benefits out of whatever profit is coming out of this venture. So these general partners, they get some remuneration, but they do not get profits of this venture. That is why they are like just like the managers, right? So that is a direct partnership program. Zyadatar they invest in areas like REITs which are non-traded. REITs, either they can be traded on stock exchange or not. If they are not, then we can count them under DPPs, right? Here you can see other features of DPP. Pooled entity offers investors access to a business venture's cash flow and tax benefits. Known as direct participation plan, direct participation program or plan. Non-traded, as I just told you, usually in real estate or energy ventures over a particular time frame. They are not traded, which means they lack liquidity. One major feature of DPP is that they are not liquid in nature, because obviously they cannot be, their units cannot be traded on stock exchange, and that is why there is no reliable pricing mechanism. क्योंकि जो चीज स्टॉक एक्सचेंज पे ट्रेड हो रही है या द सिक्योरिटी विच इज बीइंग ट्रेडेड ऑन स्टॉक एक्सचेंज, इट गोज थ्रू अ प्राइस डिस्कवरी प्रोसेस, राइट? हियर देयर इज नो सच प्राइस डिस्कवरी प्रोसेस बिकॉज मार्केट इज नॉट इन्वॉल्व्ड. ओके, डीपीपी टेंड्स टू रिक्वायर्स क्लाइंट टू मीट सर्टेन एसेट एंड इनकम थ्रेशोल्ड्स, एज आई जस्ट टोल्ड यू. मूविंग अहेड टू द लास्ट question for today. This is the last question. This question says, which of the following is about correct monetary, which of the following is correct about monetary policy corridor? Correct option for this question is option A. Option A means monetary policy corridor refers to the area between lower reverse repo rate and the upper ceiling rate of MSF rate. So guys, this question comes from your own comments. One of you mentioned in comments and asked me to take up this topic of monetary policy corridor. See, monetary policy corridor, it is nothing but a range. Range kis cheez ki? Obviously, if it is a range, it is going to have a lower limit and it is going to have an upper limit. So lower limit mein kya aata hai? Reverse repo rate. Guys, I hope you are aware of all these terms, repo rate, reverse repo rate and marginal standing facility, that is MSF. So basically, these are certain rates which are decided by RBI. जब भी monetary policy की बात होती है, we discuss के repo rate इतना चल रहा है, reverse repo इतना है, या RBI ने marginal standing facility को कम कर दिया. So if you are not sure about these terms, let me explain to you it briefly, and for more detail you can watch previous sessions in which we have discussed them in detail. See, repo rate, we just discussed it in a previous session. RBI lends to banks according to the rate which is repo rate. Reverse repo rate, banks lend to RBI. Basically, banks keep their money with RBI and get this much of interest rate. MSF, which is marginal standing facility, in this also RBI lends to banks, but for a very short term, for like one day, overnight lending, right? So this can be repo rate, can be longer than, repo rate is also a short term loan, but it can be for a few months, whereas MSF is also is only a one day loan. The major difference between repo and MSF mein, dono mein difference ek to time duration ka ho gaya ki repo rate thode lambe ड्यूरेशन के लिए आरबीआई बैंक्स को पैसा देता है, कैन बी ऑफ अ फ्यू मंथ्स, और एमएसएफ में सिर्फ एक रात के लिए देता है, ओवरनाइट लेंडिंग होती है. एमएसएफ रेट इज हायर देन द रेपो रेट. नाउ कमिंग टू वन मोर डिफरेंस, इन रेपो रेट आरबीआई परचेजेस द सिक्योरिटीज फ्रॉम बैंक्स एंड देन गिव्स देम मनी, वेयर एज इन केस ऑफ एमएसएफ आरबीआई गिव्स बैंक मनी बाय नॉट परचेजिंग द सिक्योरिटीज, only taking them as collateral, right? So this is a basic introduction to all these rates. I hope now you are clear with it. Now coming to the monetary policy corridor, it is nothing but a range in which we have decided that reverse repo rate and is the lower limit and MSF is the upper limit because this is the order. See, agar hum in tino rates ki baat kare, then the highest rate is MSF, then there is repo rate, then there is reverse repo rate. We just discussed in a previous session that reverse repo rate is less than repo rate and MSF is higher than repo rate. So, ye order rehta hai MSF greater than repo, repo greater than reverse repo. That is why we have taken both of them, MSF as the upper limit, reverse repo as the lower limit. Inke beech ka jo difference hoga, for example, if reverse repo is at 3% and MSF is at 5%, then the corridor is of 2%. Right, or 200 basis points. So this is monetary policy corridor. Now why is this monetary policy corridor important? Because within this corridor the call rate moves. Now what is call rate? Call rate bhi guys humne discuss kiya hai previous session mein. Simple terms mein call rate is the rate at which banks lend or borrow to each other, right? Banks aapas mein kaise borrow kar rahe hain, kis rate pe borrow kar rahe hain, that is call rate. Now RBI ne ye jo corridor banaya hai, upper limit and lower limit, MSF, reverse repo, this call rate should move in between this range only. Let's say agar ye 3% hai and this is 5%, so call rate 3 or 5% ke beech mein hi rehna chahiye. So that is why RBI has made this particular range, particular corridor for the movement of the call rate, basically to control its volatility. Here you can see it's RBI's monetary policy tool. With time and financial sector developments, new instruments may come. One such instrument is monetary policy corridor. Reverse repo rate, lowest of policy rates, MSF is like an upper ceiling, higher than repo rate. Corridor structure for policy rates is a helping guide to design its monetary policy operations so that it can control the call rate. See, basically RBI wants, agar banks ko koi bhi sudden problem hai ya banks are facing some sudden financial difficulties because they have to maintain certain parameters on a daily basis like SLR and CRR, right? We have discussed these also in our previous sessions. So to maintain them, sometimes they go through shortage of funds, and if they go through shortage of funds, they can either borrow by other banks, they can either borrow from other banks or they can borrow from RBI. So they want call rate to move within them, within this range, because they want that MSF should be the last option for banks, and RBI se paise mangne se pehle they should borrow and lend between themselves. So MSF, using MSF and borrowing from RBI should be their last resort. So that is monetary policy corridor. So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then do not forget to give us a thumbs up, because I'll be back in next session with some new information. Till then, you guys take care of yourself, and I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.